I want to signal out a couple of people. Andy Shalal of Bus Boys and Poets, who did the catering. I want to also call everyone who is actually Sam Adams and VIPs. We don't have our foreign counterparts in the room, but I want you all, Ann, try to stand. I know it's difficult. I want every Sam Adams person just to quickly stand up, the members of Sam Adams. There we go. Well, we got a great turnout, absolutely fantastic turnout. And if you don't know, Ray's going to talk a little bit, just really shortly. We put a censor on him on first time. But he's going to talk briefly about the origins of the Sam Adams Award. We're in our 17th year of giving awards for integrity and intelligence. And I came across this song. We're going to lead it off with a song. I found these three willing people. I only sang in high school, but
who don't know the tune and never heard the song before.
And we couldn't get it up online, but we're going to try. The lyrics are great for this song, for this whole event, as was the movie, by the way. The movie, this whole idea of integrity, and especially in a time of war when everybody is misled about stuff.
We just say that Colleen first sang with us when we were coming out of jail in Anacostia, and the Raging Grannies were there singing, and invited her to join, and she did, and so now she's returning the invitation.
All right. Okay, so bear with us.
So if you don't get the melody, the words, as Colleen said,
the words are great. We'll try to enunciate.
What can I learn from you in your lifetime, in what you've been through? How'd you keep your head up and hold your pride? In an insane world, how'd you keep on trying? One life can tell the tale that if you make the effort, you cannot fail. By your life, you tell me it can be done. By your life's the courage to carry on. Heroes appear like a friend, to light, to clear a path, or light the flame. As time goes, you'll find you depend on your heroes to show you the way. What can I learn from you? That I must do the thing I think I cannot do. That you do what's right by your heart and soul. It's the imperfections that make us whole. One life can tell the tale, and if you make the effort, you cannot fail. By your life, you tell me it can be done. By your life's the courage to carry on. Heroes appear like a friend, to clear a path or light the flame. As time goes, you'll find you depend on your heroes to show you the way.
Okay, we've got a lot of heroes, and tonight we're dedicating our award to our number one hero, Jeffrey Sterling. So, Ray McGovern, where are you? Okay. Come on up here and tell us the origin a little bit about Sam Adams and how this all started.
Well, I want to thank you, Colleen, first, and your associates for putting this thing together. What a nice crowd, you know. If somebody says, are we alone or isolated? Well, just look around here. Look around at who was around here. It's a terrific group. So Sam Adams was a colleague of mine at CIA. He had the account for counting up communists, and there were a lot of them, in North Vietnam and in South Vietnam. He came up with a figure about 600,000. Went to Saigon, General Westmoreland said, no, no, it's only 299,000. In the bar that night, one of the sergeants said, look, Mr. Adams, you really ought to go home because General Westmoreland is not going to let any more but 299,000. Long story short, Sam came back. We did an honest national intelligence estimate telling the truth, and Director Helms said, Sam, my job is to protect the agency. And we can't protect the agency by getting in a fist fight with the U.S. military when they're at war. So we're going to go with Westmoreland's figures. On the way back from that estimate, I was with Sam, and one of the high muckety-mucks of the national intelligence setup there said to Sam, now, Sam, have we exceeded the boundaries of reasonable dishonesty? I thought Sam was going to deck him. And I think he would have had I not grabbed his hand and said, no, that, yeah, okay. Well, Sam was ostracized. We were all told not to have lunch with him, okay? He went to the IG to have Director Helms investigated. That's the kind of guy Sam was. And in the end, of course, nothing happened. And Di and Sam, who had warned about how many troops there were, when Tet happened at the end of January, beginning of February 1968, after we had tried to get this estimate out in 1967, Sam sent out a little cable to Saigon saying, gosh, you were attacked by twice as many communists as there are there. How did that happen, right? The only people who escaped were the people that Bill Binney warned. Because he had the
not me personally.
Well, not you personally, but the NSA had the information, all right?
That's right.
And you told your friends out there, and they were ready for it.
ASA was.
Yeah. ASA, yeah, Army Security Agency. So what's the bottom line here? It was being corrupted even then, the intelligence, at the altar of political expediency. And we were distraught. Sam had very few friends. They focused on the fact that his shirt was always outside and he was always, you know, he was always kind of pretty
probably
determined.
Yeah, well,
no, he didn't go that far. So finally he was eased out, ended up in Vermont, I believe, and had a heart attack at a very early age. I mean, even earlier than Bill Binney is now, right now. He was, pretty early. Yeah. It's hard to imagine, yeah. Anyhow, so we decided that since Sam had no real support, Sam had no solidarity, Sam had nobody like Jeffrey or Holly to look toward, or to all those others of you who are laureates of the Sam Adams Award, that we would make it different. We would make it different, and we would honor people who had the guts to stand up and tell the truth. And that's why we're here tonight. And I congratulate you personally, Jeffrey, and Holly, both of you. I watched you at that trial. And it's so good to be with friends now and to be not only endorsed, but applauded for the gutsy stand that you took. Thanks very much, and thanks for letting me speak.
And Ray McGovern, who founded both Sam Adams and the Veteran Intelligence Professionals for Sanity, has written, if you haven't read it, go on Consortium News. Editor Joe Loria, who sometimes corrects his grammar, and read this article, which is a wonderful background piece on what Jeffrey Sterling faced and went through. It's just wonderful information, if you haven't read it so far. I only brought one copy, unfortunately, so thank you very much.
And somebody should give him a seat.
No.
Why does he have a beard on? Hey, Ray, what's your beard about?
Yeah, tell about your beard.
Ray,
tell about your beard.
Harper's Ferry today.
Yeah, some of you didn't recognize me, and this is simply because when my friend Julian Assange was carried out of the Ecuadorian embassy, I think it was April 11th, you remember what it looked like?
Yeah, like you.
And I said to myself, my God, you know, how can I find some sort of symbol to identify myself with my friend Julian? And all I can say is that I'm hopeful, and so is my wife, of the day when he'll be free quickly, and that I can return to my more staid days. But that's the reason. We tried to start a Julian Assange beer movement, but we only got two calls here, so how much for a movement? So, but any of you so inclined, and women, you know, if they could come up with a suitable symbol, you know, so much the better. We don't expect any problems.
By the way, just to chime in, that banner I wrote out there, journalism is not espionage. I don't know how people understand that. But right now our free press, our First Amendment, is on the guillotine. It's actually on the guillotine. So tomorrow morning, we're going to get up and go at 10 a.m. to in front of the DOJ on Pennsylvania Avenue and hold that banner. On the other side, it says Free Amanda Assange and Free the Press. Made it on my kitchen table. So if you are so inclined, show up and hold it and shout and whatever. So that's where without the beards, that's what we'll try to do. Okay, so I have the next people to talk maybe is Tom Drake and Jess Radak. Come on up. And you guys, some of the people that know Jeffrey Sterling the best. I tried to get them to say a few words, so go ahead.
Jeffrey, in tribute to you as a fellow whistleblower, I just want to say that history is eyewitness. As you are eyewitness and witness to history, standing on that very long arc, jumping up and down just a little bit more, helping bend it toward justice and mercy. Thank you.
And you join a long line of honorable people who have paid a very steep price for choosing your conscience over your career. And for that, you will always be the better person.
All right, do we have some attorneys in the room? Come on up. We have some really renowned attorneys. Barry Pollack, I don't know these people personally. I've never met him until tonight. But this guy, when I said Zacharias Moussaoui, we almost brought an airliner down because the darn FBI wouldn't allow him to be talked to. His defense attorney, Edward McMahon, said, yeah. Why is Ashcroft not allowing the only terrorist in custody to be talked to? Can you imagine this? This is the deceit that's gone on. It's incredible. And Barry Pollack is, you are a lot of attorneys. You're Jeffrey Sterling's attorney, and you're also Assange's attorney?
Yes.
Oh, my God. Whistleblower attorney par excellence. Oh, my God. And so I just want you to say a few words about about Jeffrey and integrity.
Well, all I'll say with Jeffrey is trying this case for you was a privilege. Barry and I had to deal with a lot of problems. Anybody that's sitting here knows what it's like to try to defend an espionage case from the basement of a courthouse. But in the end, it's very, very difficult. But if you have a client who says what he means and means it and has a wife to support him, Nancy in Dallas, to take him in, we didn't have anywhere to put him, Jeffrey. We got him back to Alexandria where he could go and be free on bail, something I don't think you could even get today. And Nancy stood up in court, and that cost her about 5 years of Jeffrey living in her house. But it was an honor to represent Jeffrey. It lasted a long time. And it's nice to see you here with so many people honoring you, as we do as well. So thank you.
Jeffrey, it's an honor to be here. It's an honor to be asked to say a couple of words. I'm very grateful they didn't ask Ed and me to sing.
Might have been better.
Look, when you go through this process, and there are a couple people in the room who have been through it, It is just a frightening, harrowing, and utterly unfair process. And to stand next to Jeffrey, who went through every minute of it with integrity intact and has come out on the other end with integrity intact, is, as Ed said, a real honor and a real privilege. So, Jeffrey, I want to thank you for the example that you've set, and congratulate you on this award, and thank everybody here for having the wisdom to honor you on this occasion.
Sorry. All right. John, come on up and say a few words.
Okay. Who's John?
John is somebody who kind of knows what Jeffrey was through. There are some of us that can really, I mean, especially John and a few others, can really bond with this whole experience of you know, sacrificing for the truth. And
John Kiriakou.
I had never met Jeffrey until I got home from prison. Unfortunately, Jeffrey was on his way to prison. And so we had a period of a couple of weeks, I think, where we were free to speak with one another. Well, no, actually, I wasn't supposed to speak with you because consorting with known felons. Just as an aside, I was accused of that last week because I'm friends with Medea Benjamin. It's true. Yeah, I'll tell you later. What struck me about Jeffrey was, while, of course, he was going through all of the emotions one would expect, anxiety, depression, he never wavered in his commitment that he had done the right thing. Never wavered. There were never any apologies. There were never any tearful, oh, what did I do? I should have kept my mouth shut. There was none of that. And so really, our conversations were conversations of hope and of looking forward to the future. Because as bad as things were, we knew that they were temporary. And when you come out of it, and it's finally behind you, and you can focus on the future, that's when you can really make something out of this whole experience. Jeffrey's there, and I'm proud to be here with you tonight. Nobody deserves this any more than you do. Congratulations.
I hadn't eaten tonight. Larry, you know, I have to say, this is one of our best Sam Adams members turnout. We have just a whole group of people. I didn't even know we're going to turn out. But come on up, Larry, and say a few words about the situation, and thanks for coming. And
surely.
Who's Larry?
Larry Wilkerson, former colonel. And if you haven't watched Democracy Now! And a bunch of other places, after the killing of Soleimani, he has been out there what I write on Facebook, he's been hitting a home run on these things, just telling the truth about the situation.
Thanks, Colleen. Congratulations to you, and my hearty applause to you for joining this august group. I want to get a little more serious for a moment, though, about another issue altogether, and I want to tell idea that the FBI came to see me because I was at your Iran gathering. Yeah, two young swashbuckling agents that I said, you don't even look like FBI. If you don't show me your badges, I'm going to shoot you on my steps. God, what a couple of arrogant assholes. I mean, and all about you. It didn't get in the middle of the conversation. We finally got around to it. Well, you were with this woman at this Iran thing. That's the state we're in now. That's the state we're in. And what we have happening right now that I've come to codify and understand in a level of detail I never thought I would approach is because I've been for 15 years on a campus with some of the brightest students in the world, over 400 of them, doing case study after case study for me. So it's not just my experience in the government for 40 years. It's this incredible, comprehensive look at what's happening to us. Right now, we are involved in a fundamental battle for our life. The battle is not as the newspapers tell you about. That's all a bunch of bull. The battle is between what has been happening for some time in this country. It's between the national security state, whose raison d'etre is war, 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 and the predatory capitalist state, whose reason for existence is to screw you out of every penny you have in your life any way it can do it. There's no deep state. The deep state is the meritocracy, the bureaucracy that runs the country when the goddamn politicians aren't there, or when they're changing, or when they're idiots like we have today. The real deep state, the pernicious, poisonous deep state, is the oligarchs who are running this country. Think about this for a minute. These two states are in a mortal battle right now with one another. You see it every day. You just don't understand it. Most people don't, anyway. You have people in both camps. ExxonMobil sells more fossil fuel to DOD than anybody else on the face of the earth. If DOD were a country, it would rank 55th in 200, right beside Portugal. Lockheed Martin is a member of the national security state, the biggest merchant of death on earth. It sells to the national security state. But they're killing each other in this battle. It's a mortal battle between the two. And guess who's in between? The demos, the people, your democracy, are in between. Your democracy's poor people are going and dying in 19 plus years of war. Your democracy's people are being forced out of their jobs. Wait till you see automation and robotics and what's coming down the road with AI. Then these predatory capitalists can do everything they do without you. Without any of the people out there that right now are worried sick about their jobs. Do you know that distress, as analyzed by medical personnel in this country, has tripled in the last 15 years? We are the most distressed country in the world. Mental health has gone to hell. Oh, just put them in the private-run prisons and they'll die anyway. This battle is existential. We won't even talk about the climate crisis that's coming down the road at us that most people are ignoring. This battle's existential. The national security state is now going to spend $1 trillion of your money to make nuclear weapons better. You know what the Pentagon thinks about nuclear weapons being better in terms of? Use on the battlefield. Those low-yield nuclear weapons we're going to develop are going to be used on the battlefield, disregarding 50 years of escalatory theory and doctrine. Oh, it won't be escalatory. The hell it won't be escalatory. The Russians have already adopted in their written doctrine the use of nuclear weapons to blunt a NATO incursion into their sphere of influence. This is all happening while we go about our daily lives and think things are maybe, you know, halfway decent, or maybe they're falling apart, whatever your thoughts might be. These two states are waging this colossal battle in your country, and the people in the middle and the democracy in the middle are dying. They're giving in to these two states. If you haven't read Tom Mueller's book, Crisis of Conscience, Whistleblowing in an Age of Fraud, you should. Read the first chapter alone. It'll make you ill. That Johnson & Johnson and their subsidiaries were able to infect children all across this country in ways that will stay with them for the rest of their lives, however short that is. That their subsidiaries were complicit. That they actually sat around in their offices and talked about the cost being worth it, because $35 billion was the profit. And the cost was only these poor people dying and so forth. Then you begin to understand what I'm talking about. You begin to understand the dimensions of the poison that is amongst us and the poison that is taking over our country and our democracy. I hesitate sometimes with my students even to call us a democracy anymore, because these oligarchs are in charge. Don't talk to me about Moscow and Putin. We are the oligarchy clan in the world today. We are the personification of what Plato and Aristotle talked about when they said, oh, let's let the rich people run everything, because they are doing that in this country. Whether it's Sheldon Adelson funding West Bank settlements, Paul Singer doing the same thing, or, yes, George Soros pretending like he's a philanthropist. There's a book by Mark Fisher, a gentleman who committed suicide in New York a few months ago. It's called Capitalist Realism. Read that book. You'll have to have an Oxford English Dictionary, a Dictionary of American Medical Terms, and so forth. But look at the stats in that book on what is happening to this country. It's just unbelievable when you look at it. And it's all because of this predatory capitalist state. That's what we are today. We're a predatory capitalist state. Don't talk to me about China and state-owned enterprises. We are a state-owned country by these oligarchs. And we're killing ourselves. And as Tom tells you in that book, the one really brilliant flash of lightning through this whole morass is people like this, and people like Bill, and Tom, and John, and Edward Snowden. They're the people who are shining at least a little bit of light on this stuff. Yeah. And Karen, and Jesslyn, and the people who defend them. That's the only thing I see out there that's shining brightly and occasionally actually gets some retribution and some accountability and some justice. So that's why this group is so important. That's why you're so important. That's why the entire concept of this is so important. Don't stop. I think it was Martin Luther King who said something to the effect of, if you're silent, you're wrong. If you're silent in the face of wrong, you're doubly so. This group isn't silent. Thank you. Woo!
Thank you for that uplifting message.
I get that everywhere I go.
Yeah, it's quite the challenge that we all have. And I think Anne Wright, if she can, she has some issues, but if she can make it up here to the front, and maybe Karen Kawakowski, who we didn't expect to show up, but she was our last year's recipient of the Sam Adams Award. Can you come up too briefly? She spoke out, by the way, really greatly. I mean, it had some impact. It didn't stop the darn Iraq war, but spoke out before the Iraq war and did it against all of those neocons, whatever. So I want you guys to really kind of give us an uplifting message.
Hey, there we go.
I don't know if that's possible, but give it a try. You
want to go first? Well, I'll make it easy for you because it's hard for me to think of. I mean, I'm with Larry on so much of the sadness and the kind of frustration that we all have, but it's really great and honor to be able to honor you here today and to recognize what you've done. And I'm in great awe of people who not just people who go to jail. That just impresses the hell out of me. I think we need more people like you. Maybe some more like me, but a lot more like you, because that's what it's going to take. Because of what Larry's talking about, this thing that we're up against it's very, very. There's a lot of evil. There's a lot of evil power with it, and it takes individual people and their actions and their faith and their strength. And you embody that. Mm-hmm.
What you did.
Oh my God. Here's the uplifting part. I actually had fun with some of the stuff I did because I was just a lowly lieutenant colonel where, you know, we bring coffee to everybody else, you know, we're nothing. I had I worked with an OSD and I saw the stuff and I saw the intel and I saw what they were saying and then I saw what was in the New York Times and Washington Post the next day, stuff that we were told was TS, but then they take the TS off and if it serves the neocon purpose, it was in the newspaper. So these things didn't make sense to me. I had a cartoon wall behind my cubicle faced a concrete wall in the Pentagon, and I had stuff taped up all over that wall. I mean, it was everything that anybody could know about me, of what I thought. Okay, any funny joke that was written in left newspapers or something that non-interventionist people from years and decades before had said about all this stupidity going around, war's a racket type stuff, history, it's not illegal. I hope it's still not illegal to have that. That's all over my wall. Anybody who came back there to give me a job to do, if it was my bosses or my coworkers or anything like that, could see it. In fact, many of my coworkers and I talked about it. They said, oh, what do you got? My contempt for what was going on, my anger about it was not hidden. But because I was a lowly, coffee pouring lieutenant colonel, I was completely hidden. It was like, whatever. So, but I wrote anonymously on David Hackworth's site about some of the stuff I was seeing in my little section of the Pentagon. And I did it kind of in a dark humor kind of way, and it got some traction, and then I did leave. I mean, there was nothing you could do. And I left, and when I left, I spoke out, and I got some help from people like Jim Webb, the senator, Senator Webb from Virginia. He called me up and said, you need to write something. He's actually the guy that called me up. I didn't even know this guy. He calls me up, he says, Karen, based on some of the stuff I'm seeing on Lou Rockwell that you're writing, you need to write something for mainstream press, because nobody reads Lou Rockwell, and you need to get out in the papers, and I will help you do that. So he helped me frame it in a way that fits newspapers, and he then worked his contacts, and he said, I have contacts everywhere in all the papers. One small paper, took him up on it. Even the mild thing that I had to say 6 months or 5 months after we invaded, that, hey, maybe lies were told, maybe you were misled. But there's good people all over the place, and maybe that's the thing, because I didn't know this guy. He calls me up, how's he get my phone number in 2003, but he does. And so there's all kinds of good around there, and maybe that will be the positive thing, because it's hard for me to be positive sometimes, but there are so many people, this room we see it in full and 100%, but there's all over the place, there are people that, they do glimpse a bit of the truth, and they are willing to act on it, and so that's a good thing, and that will save this country. If we're going to be saved, it'll be saved because of that.
Well, my name's Ann Wright, and I was a Army person for many years, and then I was in the diplomatic corps for 16 years, and then I resigned in 2003 in opposition to the war in Iraq. I was one of three diplomats that resigned, and that threw me into this group. A group that is such a wonderful, wonderful, wonderful group of people of conscience that are willing to take on the system and are willing to support people who end up in a predicament, not of their own choosing, and with no evidence put in front of a court, and get convicted of just outrageous, pardon my French, shit. It just terrible. But it is a group like this that stands with people that are in that predicament, and we're all so proud to be a part of it and to honor you tonight. Thank you.
Here, really? Is there anyone else, like at the wedding, they say, does anyone choose to object? who chooses to object? Well, we're at the moment now where we want to present our actual award. It's not a lot of, it's not millions, it's not thousands, it's zero money. Zero bucks. We're lucky we're in this nice room. But, Todd Pierce, our retired major who defended poor Gitmo, still is trying, a lot of them innocent and has heck is at Gitmo, detainees, and JAG attorney, and Elizabeth Murray, who was, we were talking about intelligence, and Elizabeth worked in the one aspect of intelligence that makes a little sense. Guess what it is? Read. Not this covert nonsense or whatever. She read a lot. She read all different publications. It's called open source intelligence. It's probably one of the best ways of learning things and knowing what's going on. not listening to, like in the FBI, Whitey Bulger tell you who's going to murder whatever, or what all this nonsense that we get from human sources and stuff telling you weapons of mass destruction are in Iraq and all this, but just plain old reading. But you know what? That probably wouldn't cost the taxpayers too much if we just hired people to read. But anyways, Elizabeth Murray and Tom Pierce are here to present the actual award.
Todd Pierce.
Did I say
Tom?
You said Tom,
yes. Oh, sorry. My best friend, Todd.
Very, very quickly, though, as a member of the Lawyers Committee on Nuclear Policy, if I may, with all respect, not correct Colonel Wilkerson, but just add that as far as doctrine goes, low-yield nuclear weapon doctrine, United States, I would argue, is far ahead of anything Russia is planning in every level of weaponry that they might have. And so let's not take our eyes off the fact that we're the ones spending close to $1 trillion per year on all wars and nuclear weapons, et cetera. And our work is at home to diminish the risk of nuclear war that we are increasing every day. But with that,
our budget is 10 times the Russian.
And as Bill Binney says, our budget is 10 times the Russian. And that's not counting NATO, who we control. Anyway, with that said, from the Sam Adams Associates for Integrity Intelligence, know all ye by these presents that Jeffrey Sterling is hereby honored with the traditional Sam Adams Corner Reitner candlestick holder in symbolic recognition of his courage in shining light into dark places. Jeffrey Sterling, a CIA Iran specialist and Farsi speaker, was jailed after going to the Senate Intelligence Committee to blow the whistle on a Keystone Cops covert operation involving an effort to document that Iran, and that's with parentheses, rather quotation marks around it, that Iran was close to getting a nuclear weapon. Committee Chair Pat Roberts was busy at the time cheerleading for the WMD justified war in Iraq. Jeffrey got nowhere, but someone else leaked the project to James Risen, who exposed it in all its feckless detail in State of War, a book. Risen said he wanted to prevent another Iraq by exposing the reckless and badly managed nature of intelligence on Iran's efforts to obtain WMD.
And stay here, Todd. Someone had to be jailed for telling this embarrassing story to Risen as a deterrent to future whistleblowers. Jeffrey Sterling, who had spoken to Risen many times in connection with an earlier discrimination complaint, was chosen to be tried and convicted by metadata, logs of telephone calls, but curiously, no content. We now know the government also had the content. According to a former NSA technical director, Bill Binney, Robert Mueller's FBI was using NSA collection of the content of such conversations. There was apparently nothing in that content that showed that Jeffrey Sterling was revealing classified information to James Risen. So metadata would have to suffice. No problem. Sentence him to 42 months. Mueller's partner in such operations, former NSA director Michael Hayden, has bragged, quote, "We kill people based on metadata." He might have added, quote, "We also put them in prison with or without content." Presented this 15th, go ahead, you tell me that.
Right.
No, go ahead. Okay.
Presented this 15th day of January 2020 in Washington by admirers of the example set by the late CIA analyst Sam Adams.
Present you also, Jeffrey, with this corner brightener and to thank you again for shining a light into a dark corner. And I'd like to ask your wife, Holly, to come up and light this candle for us. For shining a light into dark corners. We thank you, Jeffrey Sterling, and we honor you. Let's try one more time. The cameras are waiting. I think if we lift up the wick a little tiny bit. Let's see. All right. Okay. We'll just do the best we can.
Redo.
There we go. Let's just say, and Holly, we'd like to honor you with this bouquet of flowers for your courage, your perseverance, and your incredible support that we'd like to honor as you stood by Jeffrey's side throughout the entire ordeal. You deserve this honor just as much as Jeffrey does, so thank you.
I don't know how I can follow up all of that.
Can you sing?
Stop asking. But I did go prepared. Fantastic, fantastic, isn't he? Let me just jump right in. Receiving this award is a tremendous and extremely humbling honor for me. I'm truly grateful for the recognition I never thought possible or even imagined I'd be worthy of. Those who worked in intelligence, didn't do so for accolades. We chose such work to serve and hopefully make a difference. I stand here indescribably proud to be included amongst such an esteemed group of 16 patriots, awestruck to be number 17. I am extremely thankful and grateful to the Sam Adams Associates for bestowing this wonderful honor upon me. What is particularly special and meaningful for me about this award and this night is the significance of this month. 18 years ago, I lost my career to CIA for refusing to be discriminated against merely because of the color of my skin. 9 years ago this month, I was arrested. 5 years ago this month, I guess I'm going with January, I was put on trial and wrongfully convicted of violating the Espionage Act. 2 years ago, this January as well, I walked out of federal prison where I'd spent 2.5 years. It was a long time for reflection on the choices that one makes in life. But the most painful contemplation has been trying to find some meaning behind it all. How does one end up in prison for doing the right thing? And now this month signifies what I can only describe as a sort of redemption for a horrendous and unjust ordeal. Being honored with this award provides some meaning and substance to me that there is always worth in choosing to fight for oneself and one's country and in doing the right thing. And now for a shameless plug of my book. It's called Unwanted Spy, and that title fits more than just my experience trying to work at the CIA. It's also an apt description of the journey that I've been on, with this incredible night being a highlight. Growing up, I was unwanted because I chose paths for my life that were neither expected nor tolerable to many who could not accept me because of their own ignorant biases. They all underestimated my tenacity, which has been fueled by the overriding theme for me all along this journey of my life. And that is, in the words of William Shakespeare, to thine own self be true. And the Sam Adams Award and the other honorees, I believe, signify the very definition of staying true to oneself and taking a stand to do the right thing, regardless of the risk. We all, in some ways, were and have been unwanted spies. The unknowns, the nameless, the infiltrators, if you will, to systems that expected us to just get in line and do nothing in the face of wrongdoing. Our actions had no designs to betray, but instead to make our nation better by holding power accountable through truth. Yeah. It takes integrity to stand up to wrongdoing, and for me, it is and has always been about integrity to oneself. I hope to think that I share the same sort of integrity as the other honorees of this award. So for me, this has really been a hell of a journey, and I would be a fool to think that I got here on my own devices. This night would not have been possible without the incredible support I've had from family and friends who have always been steadfast in their belief and support. And also my legal dream team, which I'm glad you all got a chance to meet, Ed and Barry, and also to the multitude that wrote to me while I was in prison. You know, you all gave worth to my integrity. I would not be here without your belief in me. And a special nod goes to my lovely wife, Holly. No one could ask for a better champion or companion. She was through everything from the beginning. And fair point, I told her on our first date that I used to work for the CIA. So she may have expected some of that stuff to happen. But she's been a hell of a champion and a hell of a companion. So in conclusion to this incredible time, you know, I'd like to call attention to other patriots who chose to stand up and do the right thing, you know, that are in prison right now. Reality winner, Chelsea Manning, Terry Albury, and the many other unwanted spies out there. They should not be forgotten. Mm-hmm. Right. Again, thank you very much.
So, Jeffrey, you got to go stand over by that tippy table.
Okay, I'll go over there.
And, can you ask?
Absolutely.
So, what's happened in the last 2 years?
Well, the book, I finally came off probation last July, so that was an experience for me. With this long ordeal, almost 20 years, I was trying to remember what freedom, or not being under the shadow of CIA or FBI, really what it feels like, if I remembered what it feels like. But I worked on the book, of course. The book came out in October, but that's been an exciting time for me as well. I'm hoping to still find my next career step. You know, that's been a challenge, but like everything else, I'm just staying at it and staying hopeful, and you know, the best will come along.
So employment needs.
Yes.
Yes, okay. There we go. That's
good. Thank you for that.
That's a good point. Whistleblower. So
yes.
If we know of places for employment, please let us know. Yes. Amen,
John. Yeah.
Catholic worker.
They don't pay too much.
Any other questions? I'm open for
how long before would it take Iran to get a nuclear weapon?
I just, as we were saying earlier, I was.
Hey, listen to your attorney.
I was just dumbstruck by the escalation that Trump took.
As long as we don't help them, you know.
Yeah. So, only advice of counsel. I shall not answer that question directly, but say that, look, in any situation, anyone who's determined enough to get what they want, in this world, they can, you know, they'll find a way. Maybe there just needs to be more of an effort to get rid of nuclear weapons all over the world. Maybe. I'll tell you one thing that when I was with the agency, I went to the Nevada test site. I think you could still visit there. But it's very wide open area, very serene. And I even remember seeing there were stands there. And if you saw those old 50s, reels of you know, their training with theater, shoot off a nuclear weapon with a howitzer. There's a mushroom cloud, and the troops are walking towards it. And they're like, why are they walking towards that? Just wait. And then you know, see the people. They're smiling. The nuclear wind hits them. Like, we really have no idea what we're doing. But the most striking thing for me, and I was again at the counterproliferation division at the agency. I even studied nuclear politics when I was in college. There's this beautiful, beautiful holes. They're like bowls in the ground. And the underground test sites, they would bury the nuclear weapon, of course, underground. And it would generate so much heat, it would melt the sand and create these beautiful, just very smooth bowls. There was one in particular, it's called Sedan. They parked a school bus down in the middle of it, just for perspective. I think it's 300 feet across. And I just, how deep was that? And what damage could that do above ground? And it's so eerie seeing the beauty of it and just realizing these people didn't realize or didn't see the danger of it and that there's no use for it. And it's not a theater weapon. There's no tactical nuclear weapons. But we have policy saying, well, we use this tactical low yield. There's no such thing. Maybe if everybody goes to that tour, maybe you could see just how serene and peaceful it seems, but then realize the death that's on it, that is lying there with it. So maybe the U.S., if you want a nuclear safe world, give the weapons ourselves. Mm-hmm. What better example could there be? Any other questions? Okay. So I will man the book table. But thank you all again.
Yeah, toast.
So very much.
A toast for anyone who has any left.
So for any wine left here. So I'd like to propose a toast to Jeffrey, first of all, but also to the other whistleblowers in here that have been taken notice of, to include Larry Wilkerson, John Kerouac, who just named Bill Vinney, Tom Drake, Karen Kwiatkowski, and Jessica Raddick. And I apologize if I've overlooked anybody, but let me just add, I went to the Trinity test site, which was the original test site for the first nuclear or atomic bomb in 1945 in New Mexico. I went there last fall. Twice a year they allow people to go on to the test site. Most people are going on just to take pictures. But you go on, there's warning signs because there's still radioactivity there at a dangerous level. That's 75 years later, a atomic bomb that's much less potent and powerful than a so-called low-yield weapon of today, which destroyed two different cities, we're still being warned to stay away from the radioactive ground that it's on. So they only allow people to go on there for a brief time. So anyway, let's realize that we are the United States today, in my opinion, is the greatest threat of creating the potential for a nuclear war. And we got to bring an end to it right now because it's too dangerous, and we got kids and everything. I won't say anything more. And to Colleen, who put this thing together.
Yeah.